Good morning, Second Baptist. Good morning, First Baptist. God bless you today. Welcome to the house of the Lord. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Without any further ado, I'm going to call my friend and my brother, Deacon Clarence Wilson, forward as we begin our worship on today. Amen.
Morning. I don't know who the nervous me or my son. I have the pleasure of introducing my son today. I always have problems knowing what to say, even though I've been knowing this young man for all his life. My wife sits over there in the corner, and if I say something wrong, she'll drop her head like that. So I'm going to try to get it right today. This young man, as we were growing up, I used to put him all in the car. This is kind of a humorous part. And it was another young man that was next door, his name was Alan Beasley. I had four boys and Alan was five. And we'd bring them all to church, the Sunday school. And the way I knew that I had my right quarter, I just count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I had five in there. One Sunday, I brought the son to school, and I just took for granted all in the car. I got back home, and my oldest son, Mike, said, Daddy, you done forgot Mark. So I looked, 1, 2, 3, 4. My wife said, you done left my baby down at church? So sure enough, I turned around, and that's when we had an old church to face this way. And I turned around, and all of us came back, and there he was, walking up the street looking. So we always had a saying in the house that Mama, Mark is different from the rest of us. And Mark would say, yeah, I think y'all adopted me from someplace. So that proved what he was saying, because we had left him here at the church. He's a young man that we already married a family. Here a little while ago, during the campaign, someone asked Ms. Bush, which one of your young men that your boy that is your favorite? And she said, all of them my favorite.
That's right.
So I said, well, that's a good thing to say. So someone say, well, John my favorite, Junior my favorite. But when you say all of them my favorite, that means that you have no picks. All of them have their place in the family. He's the kind of person that my wife can count on all the time. They want to go shopping, Mark will be right there. They want to go shopping, he'll be right there. One day my wife had Mark, my oldest son, take a shop. She said, Mike, I'm just going to run here for a few minutes and pay this bill and I'll be right out. So she goes in there to pay the bill. So what happened? Mike goes in behind her. She in there shopping. Mike said, Mom, I thought you were going to pay a bill. She said, well, you weren't supposed to be in here. But Mark is the person that she can always count on. So he's got two sons. He spent the last 13 years in Texas and then moved back here. And he brought a house right across from the corner from us. So at this time, without any further ado, I want to introduce one of our favorite sons, Mark Wilson.
Good morning, Second Baptist. Thank you, Dad, for that introduction. I'm probably going to get teased for that for a little while now. Okay, so the introduction was a little early in the program, so we're going to follow that introduction with our call to worship, followed by a devotion and our responsive reading, then followed by hymn number 116.
thank God for all of us being in worship today, and we're going to go right on into our devotional experience. Why don't we stand as we sing our worship song this morning? How great is our God?
I'm not worthy of your love, but you love us anyhow. Bless these thy people. These are your people. Bless both churches this morning in a special way. We need your blessing. We've been studying about love. Teach us, oh God, how to love more. How to be faithful to you. How to love each other. By this you said we should be known as Christian by our love. Oh, bless Pastor Wallace, our pastor this morning. Bless his family. Bless First Baptist Pastor. Bless all that are here under the sound of my voice this morning. Some are sick, and some just doesn't feel well. But thanks be to God, you know us. And you love, still love. Bless us and keep us. Bless young people everywhere. Bless this world we're in.
condition of our world. Bless our president, others. Let them know that we are your people. You have the last word. Bless in a mighty way in the name of Jesus. I ask it, amen. Amen. Amen.
All right, let us stand for our scripture. Scripture reading today. All right. Peace comes from John chapter 18, verses 32 and 33, 14, chapter, verse 27, Ephesians chapter 2, verses 14 through 17, and Philippians chapter 4, verses 7 through 9. Behold, the hour cometh, yea, is now come, that ye shall be scattered, every man to his own, and shall leave me alone, and yet I am not alone, because the Father is with me. My peace I give unto you, not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid.
For he is our peace, who hath made both one, and hath broken down the middle wall of partition between us.
Having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of condemning. Contain an ordinance for to make in himself of twain one new man, so making peace. And come and preach peace to you which were afar off and to them that were nigh. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are good report, if there are any virtue, and if there by any praise, think on these things. Altogether, those things which ye have brought and received and heard, and sing. May God add a blessing to the hearer and the doer of his word. Amen. Let us still remain standing for our congregational hymn, In the Garden, found in your hymnals, number 116. Thank you.
morning again. So this is our annual Men's Day, and we kicked off our Men's Day yesterday with our pre-Men's Day retreat, and we started that retreat off with a nice breakfast. Deacon Jordan cooked a spread for us, and we had also three great speakers. Yesterday we had Mr. Lauren D. Towns to speak with us about academics. We had Myron Jenkins to speak to us about business. And then we also had Brother Mark Harris come and speak to us about health and nutrition. So we had a great time yesterday. The fellowship hall was filled. And then after we listened to all three speakers, Deacon Jordan came back and provided lunch. So we had a great time. Okay, so now we're going to have our announces by Brother Donovan Burgess, followed by a welcome from Brother John Moses.
How's everybody doing today? Good. God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
I just want to start off by this. It's a great day to be alive. I'm just glad to be here. I want to bring you the announcements today. Today is Men's Day. We are answering God's call with compassion and are donating $100 each. We are requesting $50 supporting gift from each woman of the church. to all the congregation, we are looking for ideas for our Women's Day theme. If you have any ideas, please submit them to Sister Toni Jordan today. Can Sister Toni Jordan please raise her hand so everybody knows? She's right there. There y'all go. On this coming Friday, March 17th at 7 p.m., the Second Baptist Church family will be the special guest at the retirement celebration of Reverend Garther Roberson Jr., pastor of Mount Olive Baptist Church. We are asking everyone to join in on the grand celebration. The District Layman of Huron Valley District Association announces that Brother David Rutledge of our church will be the keynote speaker for the upcoming prayer luncheon on March 25th at Polo Fields East. Contact Deacon Clarence Wilson for tickets or more information. Members and friends, please mark your calendars. Sunday, April 2nd, 2017, we will celebrate the third pastoral anniversary for Reverend George W. Waddles, Jr. Plan to enjoy a day of celebration with both a morning and an afternoon worship program. We are grateful to God for sending us Pastor Waddles, so please join us. Second Baptist family, we want our high school seniors to participate in the Huron Valley District Octoral Contest to be held on Saturday, April 15th. Please contact Sister Joyce Awishika for more information and details of contest. Immediately following worship service, the following ministries will have their ministry photo taken: Hospitality and Greeters, the Male Chorus, Brotherhood and Men on Patrol. So all men in hospitality, please move to the front of the church for your photo. Also, the entire photo schedule is in today's bulletin. Some other important dates for you guys to remember: Sunday, April 9th from 7 a.m. to 9:30 a.m., we will have the Nurses Health Ministry Sunrise Breakfast. Also on Sunday, April 9th at 4 p.m., we will have the Tessie Freeman 100 Women in White program. Saturday, April 29th at 9 a.m. at the Polo Club of Ypsilanti, all women of Second are invited to join a Wolverine State Convention sponsored free breakfast program. The Leadership Council Retreat has been moved to Saturday, July 22nd, 2017. The upcoming Leadership Council meeting will be rescheduled to a Tuesday night. The exact date will be announced later. Members and friends, please read the entire bulletin and announcement page for further particulars of Second's programs, events, and invites. Also see the vestibule bulletin board for community church activities of our sister's churches. Thank you.
Amen. We thank Brother Burgess for doing an awesome job on our announcements. And I know that we have some guests in the house from First Baptist, and just found out from Pastor Roberson that we may have some guests from Mount Olive as well. We're glad to have Pastor Roberson in the house.
Amen.
Amen. But any guests that we have, if you'd stand, we want to acknowledge your presence. Our choir has a song for you. Oh, somebody is doing the welcome. Okay, I'm waiting on him. Amen. Come on, Brother Moses. Amen. Come on.
Good morning.
Good morning.
If you don't mind, I just have to go ahead. Okay. Will all visitors please stand, please? All visitors. On behalf of Pastor Waddles, his family, his wife and family, visiting members, church members, and invited guests who have joined us for the first time, may I take this opportunity to welcome you to Second Baptist Church to participate in our 2017 annual Men's Day program. If you are visitors for the first time or looking for a place to worship, we're delighted to have you here. You can be seated.
Amen.
The 2017 Men's Day Committee is devoted to God's Word. This year's retreat and Men's Day program are significant because our focus is for all men to trust in God's power and compassion when we engage in any battle. We believe spiritual focus serves as a foundational concept as we move within and beyond the walls of Second Baptist Church. It is our goal to empower our brothers and sisters spiritually, socially, and economically. While continuing this spiritual journey, we thought it was befitting to conduct this year's celebration based on the theme, Answering God's Call with Compassion, which we believe will require men and women from all ethnicities, socioeconomic classes, and religious affiliations to join together and experience the blessing of God that God has stored for us. Today's theme exhorts men to be grounded in faith, love, and peace so we can be useful instruments for the Lord's work. That work is the same work that Christ performed when he walked this earth. These duties and needs dictate that we reevaluate each facet of the church, including Men's Day, to ensure we are following the dictates of Christ, and to determine if we are maximizing our efforts, resources, and works. These reevaluations should enable us to find solutions to current problems that cripple our personal lives, our church, and communities. Colossians 3:23-24 reads, "Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart, as working for the Lord, not for human beings, since you know that you will receive your inheritance from the Lord as an award. It is the Lord Christ you are serving. Again, we thank all of you who have found time to come and celebrate with us. And for your coming, our choir will have a song for you."
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
if the pastor would follow the program, wouldn't it? Amen. Amen. Praise God. Thank you, Brother Moses. And to all of our guests and those who are worshiping with us and those who are worshiping with us online, we say to you, welcome, and we praise God for each of you. I do want to quickly, since the man is here, acknowledge the presence of Pastor Garther Roberson. Amen. Amen. We know that he had been a big part of Second Baptist down through the years. And on the 17th of this month, we will be going over to celebrate his last anniversary, is what he's told me. I'm praying about that, but I know that the Lord has been talking to him. But we want to go over in great fashion, amen, and celebrate, amen, and encourage Pastor Roberson and Mount Olive. And then, brothers, don't forget to bring your sons and other men to the Carl Jensen Luncheon for our Huron Valley on March 25th. Our own brother Dave Rutledge will be the keynote speaker, and we're excited about that. We also want to reiterate what Brother Virgis said about the leadership retreat, because Dr. Robinson's breakfast on the 29th will pull many of our sisters away. We decided to be flexible in ministry. Amen. Amen. And so we'll have our leadership retreat on July 22nd, but we will reschedule our quarterly leadership meeting, and so we'll let you know when that's going to take place. At this time, we're going to call Reverend Chris Sharp, or whoever he has designated, to lead us in chant and prayer, and then Pastor Doug Campbell from First Baptist Church will lead us in our altar call.
Shall we stand?
Thank you.
opportunity to come in and join us. We're so happy to have the First Baptist Church family worshiping with us today. Amen. Amen. We know that we join one another usually once a year in February for our Race Relations Sunday, but I believe in our hearts we know that every Sunday ought to be Race Relations Sunday. Amen. And we know the 2 Chronicles 7:14 tells us, if my people who are called by my name would humble themselves and pray, seek my face and turn from your wicked ways, it gives us a promise. It says, and then I will forgive them their sins and heal their land. Our land needs healing today. Our communities need healing today. Our homes need healing today. And we know that there is a healer that is above all healers, and his name is Jesus. So as you make your way down to the altar, I'm going to call my newfound brother, Pastor Doug Campbell from the First Baptist Church, to come and lead us to the throne of grace. Come to the altar.
Although we were together just 3 weeks ago, at that time, we said, we want to do this more often.
Amen.
We said, we want to come together in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
It took a power outage to get us together.
Yeah.
It took powerful electricity to go out. But we've come together in the power and in the name of Jesus Christ.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So although, as Isaiah said, that the people walking in darkness have seen a great light, we have seen that great light in Jesus Christ, and although the power electricity went out, we are alive with Jesus Christ. And it is his power that we come before him in prayer right now. It is in his name that we come to glorify him, because we are one in Jesus Christ. And just as we read in Revelation that all nations will come together in the name of Jesus Christ, that we will get a glimpse of the kingdom of God, of what that will look like, of all nations, look around today.
Yes.
We come together, and that's what we do. So friends, we come together in that same name of Jesus Christ, and as we pray, I ask for all those who are carrying heavy burdens to come and bring those before Jesus Christ. Because Jesus said, come to me, all of you who are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. That is a promise, and so we come in his name, knowing that promise and that truth. And so I'm going to now ask for all of those together in the name of Christ, that as you have those burdens, to say the name of that person for whom, or the person you bring before God. So now let us bring those names, those people, before God. Father, we now come in the power and in the name of Jesus Christ. We're grateful, dear God, that we can come together as one body, the one body of Jesus Christ, to praise your holy name this morning. We thank you for the joy that is here in this church, for the witness of Second Baptist, and we thank you for the hospitality that they have given in Jesus' name. And so, dear God, as we come from all people, from all walks of life, that we come together in the name of Jesus Christ to praise you. And so, Father, even as we come before you this morning with a word of praise, some have come this morning with heavy hearts. They're here, Father, on knees, hearts breaking, because there are those we know and love and care for so deeply, and they're hurting. Father, we pray for Rose and for your healing presence to be on her. That she right now would be feeling the presence working through her body of the Holy Spirit. And Father, for all those whose names we have just uplifted to you, we pray very specifically in the name of Jesus Christ for your healing, whether that is physical, for some it is mental turmoil, and we pray for that shalom, that peace that comes from you and you alone, a healing, a peace, that shalom of a completeness that comes from you and you alone. And Father, there are others who are struggling so much with that spiritual walk of wondering, where are you, Father? That sometimes it feels like the valley and separate from you. And so right now we pray for a proclamation to be that they would come before you of saying, Lord, I want you back. I want you back this very minute. And dear God, we know that in this year here of compassion in action at Second Baptist, that we too would live out that compassion of the gospel. And so, Father, we pray right now for those who are in darkness this minute. For those who don't have heat and power, we pray for that restoration. But dear God, even more than that, of seeing that fleeting lack of electricity and of power, we are thankful for that power every day. And Father, more often we pray for that power in our lives every day, that we will not rely on the things around us in this world, but we rely on your power, on your power alone, so that, dear God, as we go from here, we go not like with batteries in us of electricity that will eventually go out, but that we are connected, that we are connected to you and to your power, a power that does not go away. And so, Father, we're grateful. We're grateful that today we have come here to worship, to hand up to those of you who are hurting, but that we can pray together in the name of the powerful and one Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And let all of God's people say, Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Bring to us the occasion, followed by the introduction of today's speaker. Trustee James Hawkins will introduce our speaker, and after that introduction, our male chorus will come to us with a selection. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. Good morning. The occasion. For more than 100 years, the church has saw the need to set aside a day to place a spotlight on and call out and set apart men whose work lives stood as Christian examples for others to follow. The church simply want to let men know that we see you, we encourage you, and we support you. That tradition continues today. Men's Day is an occasion to highlight and celebrate the wholeness of men, that achieve their achievements, not only the past and the present, but also the potential and the hope for the future. It's an occasion to appreciate men's contribution to their families, their church, community, and country. It's an occasion to affirm men's participation and leadership roles in the church. Yes. It's an occasion to recruit men to become involved in ministry, both young and old. Men's Day is an occasion to not only encourage men to support both spiritually and financially the programs and projects the church sponsors, but also the opportunity to implore men to use their gifts, talents, and resources to benefit the church and the external community in which you live. Men's Day is an occasion for us to endeavor to emphasize biblical themes that illuminate and illustrate God's call on the lives of men, which is certainly typified by our theme in Scripture this year, answering God's call with compassion, Matthew 4:19-22. Last but most importantly, this day is an occasion for men to publicly thank God for all that he has done, for the lessons learned, for the battles won, and for his grace that he has granted all of us. That is the occasion today. That is why we're here celebrating Men's Day today. Thank you.
The young, gifted, and black. To be young, gifted, and black. That's a fact. Let me assure you this morning that I'm not auditioning for the men's chorus. But I thought it would be most appropriate to begin an introduction of our keynote speaker for Men's Day this morning by introducing the young man who most appropriately demonstrate those qualities. He's young. Matter of fact, 3 days ago, Thursday, he celebrated his 29th birthday. He's single, but he's spoken for. Today's Men's Day speaker is no stranger to the Second Baptist Church. As most of you know, he has graced our building on numerous occasions, particularly during his graduate school time as a student at Eastern Michigan University. Ken Frierson is no ordinary young man. And from my personal perspective, I would say that he's extraordinary, a spiritual young man that God has gifted with an abundance of talents. If you were in attendance at our Second Baptist Church scholarship banquet last year at the Holiday Inn, you witnessed how he wowed and he dazzled the audience with a powerful and most relevant speech. Lots of amens and right on. Even our own Pastor Wallace might seem a little enthusiastic, probably thinking that he was applying for his position. There are a number of adjectives I think that I could use somewhat to describe our speaker, other than saying that he's young and he's gifted and he's talented. He's focused, he's passionate, electrifying. He's authentic. He's personable. And he's engaging.
Yes.
I could also tell you that he really personifies the issue of family. He represents the essence of family togetherness. And again, if you were there last year at scholarship banquet, you probably recognized that probably close to one half of the people who were there came from practically every state in the Union to witness him. But suffice it to say that Mr. Frierson is a highly talented individual who has achieved a great deal of success at every level. Some would say that he has the Midas touch. Success has been a major component of his evolution. Following his graduation from Flint Southwestern Academy, where his many gifts, honors, and talents were highly recognized, Ken attended Lane College in Jackson, Tennessee. And as a student at Lane College, let me tell you, he excelled. In 2007-2008, he was recognized as the Student of the Year out of all of those students.
He was the student of the year. In addition, he was the college's second recipient of the Distinguished Mellon Mays Undergraduate Fellowship. And I'm proud to say he graduated summa cum laude with a Bachelor's of Arts degree in English in 2009. And during his graduate school days at Eastern Michigan University, he served as a graduate assistant in the Office of the Ombudsman, Mr. Greg Peoples, who's with us today. His talents and skills were recognized early, and he soon took on more challenging and leadership roles in the Student Activities Office. He was Assistant Supervisor for Summer Incentive Programs in the Holman Success Center, and later he was the supervisor of their Bridge Program, where he worked closely with many first-generation and at-risk students. Proudly, Ken received his master's degree in higher education in 2011. But success continued to follow him wherever he went. Following his graduation from Eastern Michigan, Mr. Frierson was hired as the assistant director in the Office of Multicultural Student Affairs at the University of South Carolina. And during his tenure there, he oversaw the university's largest mentoring program for incoming minority students that helped increase retention and graduation rates. He received in 2003 the Outstanding Advocate for First Year Student Awards. He was recognized also for his excellence in teaching, becoming a finalist for the university's 101 program Teacher of the Year Award. Now, with this potpourri of successful experiences on his resume, Ken back in 2015 ended up going back to where much of it started, Lane College, to accept a very challenging position as the director of the First Year Experience Program. And in this unique role, he works with first-year college students, helping them to transition into college by advising, teaching, and inspiring them. But Ken clearly recognizes that he has a vested interest in their success and helping to raise a new generation of thinkers and leaders and doers whose path to greatness will be blocked only by circumstances beyond their control. Because for them, failure will not be an option. Ken's continuous message to Lane's precious students is somewhat synonymous to the message that Winston Churchill gave the British people during World War II. Never give up. Never give up. Never, never, never give up. Now, after a little over a year as the director, the students have not given up. Student retention has increased double digits, and honors and recognitions continue to flow his way. He was the nominee for the outstanding, this is after 1 year, he was a nominee for the Outstanding First Year Student Advocate Award at the 36th Annual Conference on the First Year Experience Program in Atlanta, Georgia, this past February. In the summer of 2016, Ken launched Lane College's first summer bridge program, which is a 6-week residential program for students to get a jump start on their education. How has he been able to achieve this level of success? Let me put it to you this way. Back in high school when I was a junior, I had a rather bizarre English teacher by the name of Lewis Hayner, who used to give lots of life lessons to his students. One day he wrote on the board for his students to take 15 minutes to write about. He wrote, "Failure is an inevitable condition to success." And as we were pondering and writing, and it was very quiet, and he would say, "The gods on Mount Olympus are watching you." Well, let me assure you that the gods on Mount Olympus are not watching Ken. But there is a God that's been watching him. God that you know and that I know and that everyone knows. And very close to that God that's been watching Ken Frierson has been a praying mother and a praying grandmother, and I know a praying aunt, wherever Ken Team is at. And ladies and gentlemen, sit back, relax, put your seatbelts on as as I bring this powerful man of God to you, Mr. Ken Frierson.
Stop by for trusting, Lord. Somebody here needs a feeling touch from you. If you stop by, we already know that he will make everything all right. Stop by. Oh,
hallelujah.
Oh, stop by. Somebody here needs a miracle. Stop by here and 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 stop by here. We need your arms. Need your arms around us, Lord. Somebody here needs a blessing, Lord. Somebody here needs a miracle. Stop by here. 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 If you don't stay long, please, Lord. If you don't stay long, please, Lord. Stay long.
Giving honor to God,
Amen.
Who is the head of my life,
Amen.
To Pastor Waddles, Mrs. Waddles, to Brother Newman and Deacon Reeves, to the other pastors and ministers on the platform today, and to the entire Men's Day committee, I want to say good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. So I thoroughly enjoyed myself on yesterday at the retreat. Everything was good, including the breakfast.
Amen.
I want to thank Dr. Hawkins for that resounding, amazing introduction. I feel if I have to speak anywhere, I want to make sure that I take you with me, Dr. Hawkins. We're going to just do that every time. No pressure. So there are a lot of people who came here to support me today, and I just want to ask that they would stand. If you came out here, I know, to support me today. Dr. Hawkins talked about that family. I want you to know I appreciate you. I love you. This is my uncle and aunt's church, home church, the Teemers. And I'm just so happy to be here. I'm not a stranger to Second Baptist. And so I'm happy to be here with you on this morning. So many of these folks got on planes, many got in cars, not only to support me, but to hear what thus saith the Lord. And I don't like when folks, you know, get up and speak, and preachers, they get up and they get to promoting their products and taking all the time that they got to take, you know, because I'm usually sitting right out here and I say, well, can y'all just get straight to the message? So I'm not going to delay today, but I do want to make one other special acknowledgement, and I want my mom to stand up. Yeah. I just, anytime I get an opportunity to acknowledge my mother, I want to make sure that I do that. The person who raised me and poured in so much into me for who I am today. And if you know any bit of her story, that the last couple years has been rough. And I feel like every time I mention it, I get a little teary-eyed and emotional with it. Because not only she's standing and walking and doing all that today, it was just not that long ago that she was laying in a hospital bed, not able to walk and do things on her own. So I have a miracle for a mother. And I want to just acknowledge. Brother Jordan, would you help me out? I put me in an A flat. I'm going to land somewhere around there. I don't know. Praise him. Praise him. Praise him. Praise him. Jesus, blessed Savior, he's worthy to be. Y'all sitting down like y'all don't know that he's worthy to be praised. Praise him. Come on. Hallelujah. Give you glory. Praise him. Jesus, blessed Savior, he's worthy to. There's a second verse, isn't it? It says, glory, glory. In all things, give him glory. Jesus, blessed Savior. He's worthy. Come on and let's take it out. Sing it like you know you've been in church before. From the rising of the sun until the going down. Worthy. Jesus is worthy. Jesus is worthy. He's worthy to be praised. Praise him. Praise him. I thought I was too young to know that song, didn't you? But I hear the Mount Calvary Missionary Baptist Church in Flint, Michigan. That's where my grandmother went. They said, God is my rock, hope of salvation, a strong deliverer, in him will I always rest. Praise him. Praise him. Praise him. Word. worthy to be praised. I don't think that y'all want to put Dr. Hawkins or myself in the men's day chorus, but God is worthy to be praised. Amen? I believe it's custom at Second Baptist that we stand and read the scripture. So if you are able to, please stand as we read the word of God. It's Men's Day.
Yes, sir.
The theme for Men's Day is answering God's call with compassion.
That's right.
And the scripture reference is Matthew 4:19-22. If you found it, say amen. I believe it is on the screen. And he saith unto them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. And they straightway left their nets and followed him. And going on from thence, he saw other two brethren, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, in a ship with Zebedee, their father, mending their nets. And he called them, and immediately they left the ship and their father and followed him.
That's right. That's right.
May the Lord add a blessing to the readers, hearers, and doers of his word.
Amen.
Father, we come to you this morning to thank you. Thank you for another day, God. Thank you for your loving kindness, Father. Thank you for your tender mercy. God, we thank you for your word. We thank you, God, that you would move in this service today. God, let your anointing fall fresh on us. Let your spirit move the way that you want to move, Father. I pray that you decrease my flesh and increase your spirit in me, God. Let the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart, be acceptable in thy sight, Father. God, I pray that you energize and unctionize this vessel of clay, that I may be a witness for you. That someone that may hear might say, what must I do to be saved? Lord, use me for your glory. It's in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Singing is all right.
Well,
for I do believe that we ought to sing. Praying is all right. For where would we be without a song and a prayer? But I learned here in Second Baptist from a preacher that somewhere in the country of Alabama, he said, but no gospel meeting is complete until the word of the Lord has gone forth.
Amen.
So I stopped by on this Lord's Day in March with a question on my heart, which now comes from my lips. Is there a word from the Lord? I don't stand here before you today as a preacher claiming to be a preacher, but I did stop by on my way to heaven to let you know on this morning that yes, there is a word from the Lord. If I was to put a subject, I would talk to you today from the thought of make a decision. Since I'm talking to men, and everybody in here today, but specifically I have a word for the men. I want you to know it's time to make a decision.
Right now.
Imagine for a moment, if you will, a candy store filled with the best sweet treats anybody might want. Some of y'all remember going to the candy store. It was your reward from your mama or your grandmama. And I spend a great deal of time in the South now, and they say Big Mama. Whatever it is that you called her, maybe it was your father, but when you were being rewarded for good behavior or good grades or a good attitude, you would get to walk down to the candy store. Some of y'all may know something about penny candy. Some of y'all might even remember 2 for-a-penny cookies. Am I in the right place? Well, there is this little boy. He went to the candy store one day with his father. The father told the little boy that he could pick out some candy. The little boy was bubbling with excitement. And as they walked into the store, his eyes lit up. And as far as he could see, from wall to wall, there was every type of candy you could imagine. The father told his son, go and pick out your candy and hurry back. for we have other errands that we have to run. So the little boy, now bedazzled, going up and down the aisles, ecstatic and heart racing, he selected a piece of candy and he put it back. Then he selected another and he put it back. The dad called out, "Boy, pick out your candy. We have to get going." The boy went to the next aisle and the next aisle and to the next, thinking and looking and trying to figure out which candy he wanted. By this time, the dad had waited long enough. He went and grabbed his son's hand and led him out the door. The little boy looked at the candy store with tears in his eyes, thinking about all the candy that was in that store. As he now walked up the street, empty-handed, all because he could not make a decision. And I believe that so often in life we find ourselves like this little boy, with the world being our oysters, but we leave here empty-handed. I'm talking to the men right through here. How long do you think that woman is gonna stay around? Sitting around waiting on you to make up your mind. How long? I might be talking to myself right through here. I spent some time yesterday talking to my family about how life happens, and I told them my plan today was to offer you Jesus this morning in the best way I know how, so I don't mind being a little vulnerable if I have to, but how long do you think she's going to stay? Or to you who's been looking for a car, and I know some of y'all just got your income taxes, so you finally, you found this car that's available, it's in the color you want, with the features you want, at the price you can live with. But you wish it had 1,000 less miles on it. And now you're going back and forth about 1,000 miles, and somebody else has come in and taken it off the lot. And now you're mad. How long did you think that car was going to sit there? Or you that's been talking about going to school, or going back to school, finishing that degree, getting that trade, becoming certified, how long you gonna tell us that story? By now, you could have had two or three of those same degrees. The last time you sat in the classroom, Bill Clinton was sitting in the Oval Office. Nobody knew who Barack Obama was, and Cash Money Records was getting ready to take over for the 99 to the 2000s. Now, I'm not putting anybody down. I know sometimes life gets in the way and circumstances may be out of our control, but if I could, just for a moment, we do like the preachers do. Touch your neighbor and say, it's time to make a decision. Andrew, Simon Peter, James, and John, they were sitting in the boats, and Jesus told them to follow him. The text uses words like straightway and immediately to describe the behavior and obedience of these men. Talking about Andrew and Simon Peter, in verse 20 it says, and they straightway left their nets and followed him. And of James and John, after he called them, in verse 22, it says, they immediately left the ship and their father and followed him. If I had time to deal with that, James and John left their daddy right there. See, sometimes when God calls you, you have got to leave some people behind. And sometimes that might include your family. For sometimes it's the people closest to you that can sometimes hurt you the deepest and hold you back, whether it be intentional or unintentional. And the other part is that fascinates me, in the scripture here, I don't see any dialogue between Jesus and Zebedee, the dad. And I cannot tell you exactly how old these men were, but by the context clues, Zebedee, the dad, was with his sons in the boat. That tells me that Jesus was looking for youth. And I believe that Jesus is still looking for youth today, especially our young men, especially our young black men. Don't you doubt that you are too young to be called by God, to be used by God, to do the work of God. Matthew 19 and 14, the New American Standard Bible says, "Let the children alone and do not hinder them from coming to me, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these." God is looking for young boys and men from elementary to college and beyond to take a bold stand for him today. Now, there was something interesting to me about the manner in which these men, being the first disciples, followed Christ. And what you have to understand is that these men were fishermen by trade. They were not out on the waters just shooting the breeze. This was their work, their livelihood. This was how they made their money. And Jesus shows up and says, "Y'all follow me." So what he's saying in essence is, I want y'all to quit y'all job. Quit making your money. I got something else for you. We gonna catch people. Let me put that into perspective. If Pastor Waddles showed up on your job tomorrow and said, I heard Brother Lindell singing earlier. If he said, "Brother Lindell, I need you to quit your job. It's time that we expand the membership of Second Baptist. And I'm going to need you all day for the next few years. Call Sister Linda and let her know." I imagine that Brother McLilly might take a little time before he made that call. So I wonder, why is it that these men did it? Why? Well, Simon Sinek, he's a British-American author and motivational speaker, and he has studied the work around this universal question, why? In his TED Talk, he says that people don't buy what you do. They buy why you do it. And he points out the summer of 1963, when 250,000 people gathered on the mall in Washington, D.C. to hear the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. deliver what is known famously as the "I Have a Dream" speech. During a time with no Evites or text messages and no websites to check the date, Sinek wondered how, but more importantly, why did everybody meet on the right day in the right place at the right time? Well, he concludes that Dr. King was special in the fact that he went around not telling people what needed to change in America, but what he believed about those changes. He told them why. There's always a why. And so as I researched, wondering why these men straightway and immediately followed Jesus, I was led to the Gospel of Luke. Luke told this same story, but with more detail. See, Luke by trade was a physician and was very detail-oriented. In Luke chapter 5, verses 1 through 10, and y'all have to read that when you get home because I'm working to get you out of here in acceptable Pastor Waddles fashion. And I'm already behind schedule. But what you will find in this text is that these fishermen were out fishing, but they were catching nothing. Jesus found them washing their nets. They were discouraged. But Jesus said, "Go out a little further. Put down your nets in the water again." They said, "Nah, bruh. We done been out here all night. We know how to catch fish. This is our job. It ain't nothing out here in these streets." Or these waters, excuse me. Now, of course, I'm using my spiritual imagination on how this conversation went. But even when they're with their doubt, the Bible says they complied. They went out into the waters, let down their nets, and pulled in so much fish that their nets began to break. They filled up two boats full of fish. They stood amazed, and I believe that is the why they followed Jesus. He said, "Follow me." And they remembered the miracle they had experienced, something like they had never seen before, something that only Jesus could do. So without question or hesitation, when they were called, they made the decision to answer with, "I'm going to follow him." And I believe it's time to make a decision. It's time that we answer God's call with compassion to follow him. So how do you do that? I'm glad you asked. I'll give you three things. The first, use what you got. These men were fishermen. God didn't necessarily interrupt their career. He didn't change their profession, but he changed their bait. He said, no longer will you use worms to gather fish, but you will use my word and catch men, women, and children. So you need to stop thinking that you don't have what it takes to be this or that. I think that's the message today. God will use your talents, gifts, and abilities for his glory. He will strengthen the skills you already have to fulfill your purpose. Young man out there listening, you are good enough. Despite your past failures, in spite of your current sins, God is looking for ordinary people to do some extraordinary things. And he's about to do something big, and I believe he's looking for game changers, but you've got to make the decision to get in the game. You want to be a professional athlete? Then take God onto every field and into every arena you visit. You want to run for a political office? Take God into every meeting and put him into every policy. You want to be a barber? Minister to every person that sits in your chair. God does not call you and require you to lose your skill set or your personality. Brother Lawrence Towns yesterday blessed me when he said, I'm not who you think I am. I'm everything you thought I can't be. And that says to me that God placed this purpose in me when he created me. For he knew the plans he had for me before I was even formed in my mother's womb. So whatever your lot, God can use you. I'm rushing on. Point number two. If we are going to follow God, answer God's call with compassion, we cannot do it if we don't learn to love. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. And I believe, men, that God has given us women to teach us how to learn to love. Clearly, God has infinite wisdom and humor. And I think he sits back and laughs at us men sometimes because sometimes we just don't get it right all the time. Well, let me talk about me because y'all quiet. I know that I'm learning to love myself and other people better because of the woman in my life. Now, I'm not married yet, and I don't always get it right. In fact, I don't believe married men always get it right. That was the part for the sisters to say amen. But I do know that loving a woman will teach you patience. What do you want for dinner? It doesn't matter. So then you name a restaurant. I don't want that. Patience. You want to say, I just asked you if you, but you might remember maybe one of your grandmamas might have said, y'all be sweet now. But my brothers, that's okay because we know that tribulations worketh patience and patience experience and experience hope. Here's for the brothers. High five a brother and say, keep hope alive. The Bible says love is patient, love is kind. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. I think many of you, you've heard a man named Lenny Williams. He wrote a song that said, girl, you know I love you. What's the next line? What's the next line of that? No matter what you do. Y'all don't look at me funny. Y'all know the song. Y'all know the lyrics. But here's the deal. It's that same kind of love that no matter what you do, God loves you. In fact, it's an even better kind of love because Jesus is love. And I am convinced that nothing can separate us from God's love. Come on, Romans 8 and 38 and 39. Nothing in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord. That's why if we're going to answer God's call with compassion, his love must be in us, and we must learn to love. Lastly, and I'm out your way, the third point is be obedient. Obedience is better than sacrifice. These men were obedient to the call and cause of Christ. What would have happened if they stayed there? I don't know. Maybe they would have had a good life. Maybe everything would have worked out all right. They were pretty good fishers. But God wants to move you from good to great. For greater is he that's in you than he that is in the world. You don't have to settle. You may have to leave your daddy right there in the boat. You may have to leave your girlfriend or a best friend. But God said, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. It is recorded in Luke 6 and 46. So why do you keep calling me Lord, Lord, when you don't do what I say? It's time to make a decision to be obedient to God. I know that at Second Baptist, y'all know when it's time to go because Pastor Waddles, he gets to tune up a little bit and he goes on. Brother Jordan, I don't know if you put me in a C sharp, we'll get on out of here. I call this, it's time for the final countdown. Jesus gave the ultimate example of obedience when he said, I must be about my Father's business. We've got to look at why Jesus died. Why? To give you a seat in heaven. To heal you, make you above and not beneath. The head and not the tail. There you go, right there. It's time to make a decision. Don't worry about what they say. They lie. If they lie on Jesus, I'm confident they will lie on me. But I'd like to tell them, if you dig one ditch, you might as well dig two. Because the ditch you dig for me might end up being for you. Don't let nobody stop you. You've got to be like the old saints and say, ain't gonna let nobody turn me around. And I'm so glad that Jesus didn't let anybody turn him around. But he rode into Jerusalem on a donkey. The people cried, Hosanna, Hosanna. And a few days later, those same people cried, crucify him. Let me speed up the story. He was bruised and beaten. He hung, bled, and died. But early, I said early, one Sunday morning, he got up with all power in his hands. I'm so glad that Jesus died. If y'all help me with the final countdown, I'm going to my seat. Come on and help me count down. 10, 9, wait. I didn't say 8. I said wait because I want you to know that not only am I glad that he died, but I'm glad that he lives. He lives in me. Rick Warren tells us that through salvation, our past has been forgiven, our present is given meaning, and our future is secured. 8, 7, 6. I thank God for a secure future, but I want you to know that living for Christ does not exempt you from circumstances, situations, and setbacks. But the good news is, no weapon formed against you shall prosper. It doesn't mean that the weapon won't be formed, but it will not prosper. Paul said in 2 Corinthians 4, 8 and 9, we are troubled on every side,
yet not in distress. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but not destroyed. 5, 4, 3 is for the Trinity, the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. 2 is for the natural birth we have all experienced and the spiritual rebirth that we may all experience. 1, and I'm going to my seat, is for one body, one spirit, one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God who made one decision a long time ago. He died for you and for me. He died. He decided to die for you so that you could decide to live for him. It's time to make a decision. God bless you today. God bless you today. It's time to make a decision.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Somebody in this building, you might be here today. I need a little more. You might be here today and you have not received Christ Jesus as your Savior. You recognize that you are a sinner and that without him you are lost and on your way to hell. But you heard Brother Frierson remind us today that you need to make a decision to follow Jesus. The Bible says that we have all sinned and come short of the glory of God. And the Bible says that the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. If you're here today and you want to make a decision for life, you ought to come right now. Won't you come receive Jesus as your Savior today? Or if you just want to join the church and God has placed it in your heart to be a part of Second Baptist Church or First Baptist Church, we'll send you where you want to go. Just come now while the blood is running warm in your veins. I have decided to follow Jesus. If you know that, join us. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning. I have decided to follow. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow. No turning back. You may be seated. Sister Clerk, will you tell us who we have, please?
Pastor Wobbles and Second Baptist Church family, we have Bridget Johnson and Melody also coming for prayer, both of them.
All right. All right.
My Second Baptist Church family, praise God. It's been a rough two weeks for me and my family. This coming week, I'm going through a surgery, and I'm asking for all prayers. I'm not going to shed a tear, right, because I know I'm covered,
that's right,
in the blood of Jesus. I don't have any doubts. I don't have any words because I know he has touched me. And I'm just asking all of my Second Baptist Church family and friends just to pray for me and my sister Carmelita in the death of her husband, which was her best friend. I love you, Second Baptist. Pastor Waddles, thank you so much.
Amen. Sister Melody is coming for prayer for academic success. Amen. She's doing well, but she wants to keep going, and she has some goals in mind. How many know that the Lord will keep you even in the classroom? Amen. I'm going to ask the sisters to come stand with our sisters while we pray, if they would. Amen. Father, here we are. We know, God, that you know all. We know, Lord, that there's nothing that happens in our life that you haven't seen coming, that you haven't given us the strength for already in advance. So we ask, God, to touch Sister Bridgette, God, as she is under the care of the doctor, Lord. You know that, God, those doctors are just practicing medicine. They're not the medicine. But you are the medicine. You are our healer. And God, we ask you to give her sister, Carmelita, strength. Lord, as she's dealing with the loss of her husband. Lord, you said in your word that when our father and mother and other family members leave us, that you would take us up. And so, God, we ask you to take up our sister, Lord. Lift her head up, lift her heart up. And God, let her rejoice for the days that she had together. But God, give us strength for the journey ahead. Lord, we lift up to you Sister Melody, Lord, who has struck out on faith, Lord, and is working toward this certification. We know, God, that you gave her the strength to get this far. We ask you to give her the strength and every necessary resource, Lord, to finish what she started. Lord, that she might serve you even better. Now, God, there may have been someone that should have moved but got trapped in their seat. Lord, we ask you to release them, Lord, and allow them to come to you, God. And before it's everlasting too late, save them, God, that they might walk in the newness of life and have Christ as their Savior and Lord. We thank you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Can we say amen for the word of God today? I'll never forget, I started driving at the age of 13. I'm looking around the room to see if any of our officer friends are in here. But I started driving at 13, and one time when I was about 16, my father told me, he said, go out there, get my keys, I want you to go to the store. He gave me a grocery list and some money. And I said to him, Dad, I don't have a driver's license. He said, boy, don't you worry about that. Just do what I said do. Brother Frierson was in that vein today. He don't have a preaching license yet. But he went on about his business. Amen. And I want to tell you in public what I told you in private. Keep holding on to God's hand. And learn all of this that you can. It's evident to us. Amen. That the Lord is working on you, but you keep following him and your pastor. Amen. And if you will do that, God will put you where he wants you to be. Amen. Amen. Brothers, weren't we challenged by the word on today? Amen. This time we're going to prepare ourselves to give. Men of Second, you know what we've asked every man to do. And if you don't do it today, do it next Sunday. Amen. We want every man who can to give $100 toward our men's day. And if you're watching us online, you're able to join us in giving. Just go to easytide.com/SBCYPSI and you can join us in giving. I believe at this time we'll bless the offering. Father in heaven, we thank you. Lord, we give you praise. We ask that you use these gifts for kingdom building, to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. In his name we pray, amen. Our ushers are coming now to direct us in our giving. Let's follow their instructions as they guide us in our giving. The trays on the side are our tithes and offering. The two trays in the middle are the benevolent offering. Amen. Would you stand at this time?
Thank you.
Can I ask the brother who's in charge today, Brother Mark Wilson, to come, and he will have called Brother Newman and Pastor Roberson to give remarks. Amen.
Okay, next on our program, we have our program chairman this year, Brother John Newman, to come forward to have remarks. After his remarks, Brother Garfield Roberson. Reverend Garfield Roberson.
I'd like to thank Brother Kenneth Frierson for that word. God truly has a plan for you. And I'm sure I'll be hearing portions of your word when I get home. I would like to ask the members of the Brotherhood to please stand. Through the Brotherhood, a committee was formed, and I could not have done it alone without them. I am only the chairman, but together we did this as a group. So thank you. Amen. To Sister Mildred Williams and Sister Anita Orr, I thank you for your assistance and your patience and understanding working with me. And with that, I'd like to turn it over and also let you know that Brotherhood meets every first Saturday at 8:30, and we look to see you there.
Amen. Amen.
What seemed as an overwhelming task was made manageable, and I'm a testimony that with God, anything is possible. Amen. When I was first selected, I thought that I was hoping there was another John Newman in the room, but through the help of the Brotherhood and the Men's Day Committee, this was very possible, and I enjoyed every minute of it. I'd also like to thank my wife for supporting me those Thursday nights that I was here. Thank you.
Say, bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord.
Can we say it one more time?
Bless the Lord.
We thank God that we have had this opportunity today. God is always doing marvelous, miraculous things that we don't understand until we get in the center of those and realize why I'm here today. On this great Men's Day, we can see that the power of the Lord was surely in this place.
Amen.
To Brother Frierson, that gave us a dynamic. Dynamic word from the Lord. He reminds me of a very good friend of mine that was a part of us in the district in Detroit when we used to be a part of the district in Detroit. We call it METSI, the Metropolitan District Congress for Christian Education. There was a young man who was a deacon, and he spoke here many times.
Yes.
But when God have men that he has given the power of being able to speak and be able to utilize what God has given them, and I know everybody's saying, you, oh, he's going to preach. But this young man, and he's quite elderly now, but everybody said, you're going to preach. He says, no, he called me to teach.
Amen.
And I don't know what God is calling, but don't let nobody push you in any direction, but let God be the one. Amen. Your word was pure and it was directed in the right direction, and I think we all were lifted and will be better men for it. I had to be here today because we know we had power outages all over the state of Michigan, including the city of Ypsilanti, and many of my friends still do not have power. But we had power outage all around the Mount Olive Baptist Church. And the church had power. But all around it, because of some of the poles that had fell and electric wire that was around, they put up these long yellow streamers all around the church and the street. And we were not able to get them to come. I'm gonna have to look at somebody. We gotta have my pastor's anniversary beginning on Wednesday, and we surely don't want to disappoint those who have planned. Amen?
Amen.
But to Pastor Wattles and to the Second Baptist Church, this is my home, born, raised here, bred here, lifted up here. And I was called in the ministry from here. So you know that I feel very comfortable. It's good to be home. I look down and see some of the deacons that I was deacons with when I was here. And I thank God. I'm looking to see so many of you that are still carrying on. And I just wanted to have a time to say, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and let us forget not all of his benefits. Thank you.
Certainly praise God for Pastor Roberson. He is a man that we learn much from. Amen.
Amen.
And we want to thank God for the relationship of First Baptist and Second Baptist being able to worship together. I think it was awesome. Amen. Pastor Doug and I were saying we ought to do this more than just once a year. And so we'll be praying about that. I do want to thank our general chairman, Brother Newman, and all of the brothers that worked so hard. We had an outstanding men's retreat on yesterday. Amen. And we thank God for all of the presenters. And I don't want to call too many names that I forget somebody, but I know the brothers won't be mad, will you? Amen. Amen. And Sister Linda, I didn't say anything. She's in the back listening. I didn't say anything to Brother McLilly about quitting his job. Amen. I just want to be on record for that. Amen. Amen. But should the Lord tell you something, brother? Amen. God bless you. Let's stand now and we'll have our dismissal song and then we'll go home. Amen. When we do, we're going to ask you to greet Brother Frierson. Let him know how you were helped by the word of God today. Auxiliaries who are scheduled to take pictures today, please make sure you see Brother Reeves. Amen.
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 Father, how we thank you for this great word today. We thank you for these men. We pray, Lord, that our faith has been encouraged, that our determination has been sharpened, and Lord, that our will to follow you has been renewed. Now may the grace of God, the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, and the love of Christ rest, rule, and abide with each heart henceforth and forevermore. We all sang together.